When this munition hits the target, its primary mechanism of destruction is the shock wave of the explosion. The thing is, point detonating rounds keep the damage localized and focused on the target. But this round will never hit the target, at least not in one piece. Instead of hitting the target with one strong shockwave, these rounds cover a much larger area using shrapnel, where thousands of metal fragments can take out infantry and lightly armored vehicles. They are called airburst rounds because they explode in the air without ever coming into physical contact with anything. But this means that they have to get one crucial thing right, and that's timing. If they detonate even a fraction of a second sooner or later, it could mean missing the target area altogether. And as you'll see, getting the timing right is not always as simple as setting a timer on the fuse. In addition, determining when to explode very much depends on the type of target that's being eliminated. This, and this are all airburst rounds, but each one uses a totally different approach to calculate the time to burst. An aerial threat that's recently entered the combat scene is FPV drones. You can see them getting shot down here, but they're not being targeted individually. Instead, Rheinmetall's Skynex 35mm gun is shooting at them with airburst rounds. These rounds are clearly exploding way before reaching the drones. It's the fragmentation that destroys them. But here's the cool part. A rangefinder can determine the exact distance to the target, and knowing the speed at which the round is fired, the travel time to target can be calculated. The thing is, these rounds don't all move at exactly the same speed. Even small variation in the charge and temperature can ever slightly impact the muzzle velocity, which is the speed of the round at the exact moment it exits the end of the barrel. To account for these variations, the muzzle velocity of each round is measured individually. Then, using induction, the corrected time to burst is written into the round's electronic time fuse as it passes through the programming station of the muzzle, resulting in better accuracy. Now compare that to this other type of anti-air defense, which also uses airburst munitions and fragmentation, causing enough damage to the cockpit and the engines to bring down an aircraft. In this case, the time to detonation is controlled by a proximity fuse, not a timer. Proximity fuses do not detonate after a set amount of time. Rather, they use radio or optical signals to see how far they are from their target as they move toward it. Then, at a preset distance to the target, they trigger the munition to explode. With proximity fuses, even a near miss can be totally fatal, thanks to the cloud of fragments that's generated in the air. Proximity fuses provide a simpler and more consistent result than time fuses, but that requires proximity to a target, which makes you wonder, what if the threat is not visible? For example, when the target is behind a wall or hiding inside trenches. Well, here is a genius solution. These 30mm airburst rounds are programmed similarly to Skynex, by induction, as they pass through the muzzle. But there is a big difference in how they calculate their time to burst. In addition to a timer, they also use a rotation sensor to calculate the distance traveled from the gun. See, most guns have rifling inside their barrel, which forces the rounds to rotate as they shoot out, giving the projectile more stability in flight. But given that the twist rate of the barrel is fixed, every spin equals a precise amount of forward travel. By counting these rotations, the fuse can pretty accurately calculate the distance traveled and ensure the munition is triggered precisely where it needs to, especially over shorter distances. The result is perfect spacing between the rounds and exactly over the trenches for maximum damage. These rounds could also be used to attack threats hiding behind barriers by first penetrating through the barrier and only detonating once they've reached their destination. The story is not much different on the water. Although, I don't know what's more impressive, those airburst rounds or the little boat that's still floating after getting hit so many times. Airburst rounds should not be confused with cluster bombs, even though they have some similarities. They're both used to inflict damage on a large target area without having to aim for a particular target. And they both accomplish this by saturating that area with destructive fragments. It's just that with airburst rounds, those fragments are inert. But with cluster bombs, the fragments are smaller bombs, also called bomblets or submunitions. So what, one might say? What's the difference between dropping one really large bomb versus 1,000 small bombs during a war? Well, there is no issue per se. It's just that the problem with cluster bombs begins after the war ends. The best cluster munitions have an advertised dud rate as low as 1.5%, meaning that 1.5% of the bomblets hit the ground but don't explode. It may not seem like a lot, but considering that 2 million cluster submunitions were dropped on Iraq in 2003, even a 1.5% failure rate results in 30,000 unexploded bombs sitting around. And that's the best case scenario. Since the end of the Vietnam War in 1975, it's estimated that more than 60,000 people have been killed or injured by these hidden explosives in Vietnam and Laos. That's the result of the 8 million tons of bombs that were dropped across Southeast Asia, making Laos the most heavily bombed country on the planet, a harsh reality that continues to complicate the lives of the civilians in that region for decades to come. This should explain why the vast majority of the countries in the world have agreed not to produce, stockpile, or use cluster munitions. That said, some major powers, including China, India, Russia, South Korea, and the United States, have refused to sign the Convention on Cluster Munitions. Now, you might be surprised to hear that there are even some regulations around airburst munitions. For example, dense metals like steel and tungsten are the typical choice for fragmentation because they can penetrate better and cause more damage. However, it is illegal to use non-metallic materials like plastic and glass in airburst bombs, especially when used against personnel. But can you guess why? It's simple. Glass shrapnels will be quite difficult, if not impossible, to detect under X-ray, making it extremely challenging to treat those injured by it. Ironically, a study showed that tungsten alloy shrapnel might cause cancer if left in the body for a long time. I guess just hope you never get hit by shrapnel. And if you ever do, you can blame this guy. In the late 1700s, the British invented a hollow bomb casing with lead balls inside, a rudimentary airburst bomb. The guy who came up with that idea was Lieutenant Henry Shrapnel. Yes, that's why today deadly bomb fragments are called shrapnel. And this is what happens when tens of thousands of shrapnels hit a metal roof and turn it into Swiss cheese. But what could do this? The M30A1 HIMARS rocket with alternative warhead, which packs approximately 182,000 preformed tungsten fragments, as it explodes approximately 33 feet above the target. Now, if you ever wondered what it looks like to mix cluster munitions with airburst shrapnel, look no further than the CBU-97 sensor fuse weapon. This 1,000-pound free-fall cluster bomb unit delivers a powerful punch in the most unusual ways. After being dropped from an airplane, the outer casing opens and releases 10 BLU-108 submunitions. Each BLU-108 is a cylinder as tall as a guitar, but equipped with a parachute to slow down its descent, and also to keep it vertical as it approaches the targets. Suddenly, the submunition detaches from the parachute, while small rocket motors provide angular thrust, rotating the cylinder at such high speeds that make it ascend. Each BLU-108 submunition contains four hockey puck-shaped sensor fuse warheads called skeets, which are released into four different directions like frisbees. Each skeet is equipped with an infrared seeker and a laser ranging device. The infrared seeker scans and identifies targets on the ground, and the laser calculates the range for exact timing of the release. The warhead is an explosively formed penetrator made of copper with a shrapnel ring all around it. Once it locks onto a target, the skeet fires the penetrator, similar to the Russian top attack PTKM-1R. The explosively formed penetrator can easily destroy heavily armored vehicles. The job of the shrapnel ring is to damage anyone or anything soft near the target vehicle, which would suck even more if the inventor of the first Airburst bomb was not Henry Shrapnel, but a guy named Henry Cox. Did you know that Not What You Think has a community Discord? It's a place to connect with other fans, join community events, play games, and much more. Just click the link below. We would love to see you there.